This land is composed of two different cultures, a white culture and a colored culture, and I've lived close to them all my life. But I'm told now that we've mistreated them and that we must change, and these changes are coming faster than I expected, and I'm required to make decisions on a basis of a new way of thinking, and it's difficult. It's difficult for me, it's difficult for all Southerners.
Five score years ago, a great American in whose symbolic shadow we stand today signed the Emancipation Proclamation. This momentous decree came as a great beacon light of hope to millions of Negro slaves who had been seared in the flames of withering injustice. It came as a joyous daybreak to end the long night of their captivity. But 100 years later, the Negro still is not free.
On April 9, 1865, General Robert E. Lee, commander of the Confederate Army, surrendered to Union General Ulysses S. Grant. This would mark the end of the American Civil War. The bloody war had raged on for four long years and had cost over 700,000 lives. The very election of the so-called Black Republican Abraham Lincoln propelled 11 Southern states to secede from the Union. In his first inaugural address in 1861, President Lincoln said, "We cannot separate. We cannot remove our respective sections from each other, nor build an impassable wall between them." At the core of the struggle was slavery. The slave power of the South desperately wanted to preserve their way of life. The plantation culture sustained itself on the blood and sweat of 4 million enslaved African Americans. Cotton was king in the South. President Lincoln's Emancipation Proclamation was more about crippling the South than freeing the slaves. The South was using slaves in the war effort, and what better way to weaken them than to take their property? In this effort to keep the Union together, Lincoln's proclamation only freed slaves in the rebellious states. Slave states, such as Maryland, had remained in the Union, and with such close proximity to Washington, Lincoln did not want to push them into secession. As slaves escaped from plantations and went north, they were quickly picked up by Union forces and used in various jobs. Eventually, they would be used to fight in the army, but still endured much racism from Union soldiers. They were also paid less than white soldiers. It was not uncommon for colored soldiers to be murdered when captured by Confederate troops. In 1865, with the war coming to an end, Lincoln had very clear ideas on Reconstruction. Sadly, that would not come to pass. On April 14th, while watching a play at Ford's Theater in Washington, Abraham Lincoln was shot. He would die the next morning. Lincoln became the first U.S. president to be assassinated. Vice President Andrew Johnson would become president. Under his administration, and in spite of the 13th Amendment outlawing slavery in America, former Confederate states would enact laws known as Black Codes. These laws severely limited the freedom of former slaves. In 1876, legislation known as Jim Crow laws were enacted to further segregate African Americans in a policy that essentially kept them separate but equal. The laws further separated them from whites in schools, housing, jobs, and public gathering places. In 1890, a new Louisiana law required railroads to provide equal but separate accommodations for blacks and whites. The law was challenged and would be heard by the Supreme Court in 1896. The ruling handed down by the court was another blow to the struggle for equality. It ruled that segregation in America was constitutional. The Ku Klux Klan was founded in Pulaski, Tennessee in 1866. This group and similar groups were responsible for the deaths of over 3,000 African Americans between 1882 and 1968. In 1955, Rosa Parks was arrested for refusing to give up her seat to a white person on a bus in Montgomery, Alabama. This one act would become the symbol of the modern civil rights movement. Medgar Evers was among the courageous people who fought the struggle for equality. He was born on July 2, 1925, in Decatur, Mississippi. Education for Medgar didn't come easy. He sometimes walked 12 miles both ways to school. Evers joined the Army during World War II and later was discharged in 1946. He then attended Alcorn College, where he participated in many school activities such as the debate team, football, and track teams. At Alcorn, he met Merle Beasley. They married on December 24, 1951. Evers applied to the University of Mississippi Law School in February 1954. After being rejected because of his color, he volunteered to help the NAACP try to integrate the university with a lawsuit. Thurgood Marshall served as his attorney for this legal challenge. He ultimately failed to gain admission to the law school, but Evers raised his profile with the NAACP. Evers and his wife then moved to Mound Bayou, Mississippi. Later, Evers was appointed Mississippi's first field secretary for the NAACP. Evers traveled around Mississippi extensively. He recruited new members and organized voter registration efforts.
We're not just interested in voting so that conditions will be improved for Negroes. We want conditions improved for everybody.
In the 1960s, his boycotting of Jackson merchants attracted national attention, and he was also involved in the fight to have James Meredith admitted into the University of Mississippi in 1962. Meredith was admitted to Ole Miss, a major step in securing civil rights in the state. However, a riot on campus left two people dead, and Evers' involvement in this and other activities increased the hatred many people felt towards him.
I've had a number of threatening calls, people calling me saying that they were going to kill me, saying that they were going to blow my home up, and saying that I only had a few hours to live.
While a virtual unknown elsewhere, Evers was one of Mississippi's most prominent civil rights activists. At 12:40 a.m. on June 12, 1963, as he was exiting his car in the driveway of his home, he was shot in the back. He died less than an hour later. Evers was buried with full military honors in Arlington National Cemetery. The national outrage over Evers' murder increased support for legislation that would become the Civil Rights Act of 1964. His suspected killer was Byron Della Beckwith, a white supremacist and a member of the KKK. In spite of a rifle being found close by with Della Beckwith's fingerprints on them and several witnesses placing him nearby, two trials resulted in hung juries. It was not uncommon at the time for all white juries to fail to convict people charged with crimes against African Americans. In 1994, after 31 years, Della Beckwith was finally convicted for the murder of Medgar Evers. He was given a life sentence and died in prison. Medgar Evers is a hero to many because he worked endlessly to bring civil rights to African Americans in spite of numerous threats against him and his family. This turbulent era would see many more deaths in the struggle for equality. We owe an enormous debt of gratitude to the brave people who lost their lives in the struggle for equality.